Here we are this morning to worship you, to adore you, to listen to your word, and to share the sacrament. Speak to us because we need you. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Say joy to me upon joy. And in my heart I had longed to visit you, but it has never happened. So I'm glad to be here and be with you. Also, it's my longest time in Canada. My first visit in Canada was in 1990. I was invited by the Anglican Church of Canada. I was more in Montreal. So when I went back to Congo, where I was a bishop, they asked me, did you really visit Canada? I said, yes, I was in Montreal. I was in Ottawa, a beautiful city, you know, surrounded by the canal, wonderful flowers. They said, you didn't really see Canada. Canada is in Vancouver, in British Columbia. And then I came for a weekend. Beautiful country. But I went back to the broken heart. As we were going up the mountain, there is a small church just below the road, which belonged to the Anglican Church, which was on sale. And you people, when I say you, you had one to buy that church, and the Anglican Church of Canada refused. And let alone it was sold, I don't know to whom. So in my talk, when the Holy Spirit allows me, I'll be talking about the empty church. It's more and more I was thinking we need to pray for Canada. Empty church. Has there ever been genocide in Canada? As it was in Rwanda, losing over 1 million? It depends on how we interpret it. It can be physical, it can be spiritual. But this time I have stayed a little longer and I have visited the island, beautiful place, quiet place. And then I find there my brother from South Africa, a strong man, a man of God. Greetings from my wife, Frida. She was not able to come. Her mother is not well. But she sent her greetings. Yesterday, I started preparing my sermon. I asked him, would you remind me what's the theme? What do you want me to share with you? Then she reminded me. So I picked up a piece of paper, started, you know, praying. When I went to the hotel again, but I was so tired. Then I woke up very early in the morning. A few things came in my mind and in my heart. One which came very strongly after breakfast was about the war. The war in Syria, the war in Iraq, the war between Islam and the rest of the world. Then I was asking myself, isn't this a spiritual war? Because it comes under the name of religion. I'm an African, I don't need to be politically correct, I see. And I'm a preacher. I have to be very careful, but that's who we are. So I thought, isn't this a spiritual warfare? It seems I was saying, yes, why would it come under religion? Islamic world. Why that? What's their problem? It's emptiness. Empty churches would mean empty hearts. Then jihad has to rise up. They have no hope. They have no direction. They don't see the destination. Then they engage the war. It's a spiritual warfare. But why does it begin? Empty church. Not necessarily people have left the church. They empty words. The time of Samuel, the word was rare. Empty church. Empty world. Godless. Muslims at a time. And they get in the war. And we get them. It's a war of the church. And the commanders are the church leaders. Archbishops and the bishops and the priests. But have nothing to say to the world. The Savior is no longer there. There is no Redeemer. The Messiah who came to liberate is not there. He's in hiding. It's a spiritual warfare. Commanders are the church leaders. And then the politicians come behind them. Canadians and the American, the world, the Western world, they have money. The Lord bless you. And they don't know what to do with your money. You manufacture guns. You make guns. You sell guns to Muslims to kill each other and kill you. You have your sons and your daughters. You send them at war. How much do you pray for them? Pray, stop the war. Don't send them to war. I think to me this came as a warning to you. In the 70s, there was redundant churches in England being sold to Muslims, becoming public buildings. Same in Australia and New Zealand, same in America and here. Where are people? They don't need God anymore. They became their own gods. You have money. Your account are your gods. You don't need God anymore. God is for the poor. But who is poor? Poor because I don't have money? Who was poor between Lazarus and the rich? Who was poor? Eventually. At the end of their journey, who was poor? Who was begging the other? Abraham, would you tell Lazarus to give him a drink? No way. He had understood. Send him back to my brothers and sisters. Tell them where he is and who he is. I said to my son, God is still so kind. Moses and the prophets are there. Let them hear them. Let them listen. Lazarus listened to them and his ear. Who is poor? Is Lazarus suddenly suffering? Or is it the rich man? His end was it a disaster? Who is poor? Where do you send money? You say your money goes to Saudi Arabia to destroy Africa. $5 million US dollars given to Muslims in Africa. Their target was 19 to 2010. Africa would be Islamized. And then 2015. They always have a plan of 50 years. Now they are planning, I think, 2030 or 50. They haven't given up, but they want Africa. It's my prayer. They are Africans who will not understand. I was in Uganda at the time with the Amin. Having my dog collar was a death warrant. We are not afraid. I was on my bicycle preaching the gospel. We have experience of Ugandans back alive. The youngest was 13 years. We are at war. But who is at war? It's a spiritual warfare. It's in the church at war. God is at war with the church. God is at war with the world. God is warning the world. Come back to me. Turn back to me. Otherwise, what you see will be worse. That wasn't my sermon. It was my warning. Let's go back to the text. I wonder they were struggling with the question, give us faith. Disciples talking to Jesus. Faith in who? Is he not there? What does it mean? What do I try to say? Faith in him, is faith to do, is faith to understand. What were they trying to say? But as I read verse 4, I was trying to maybe to put the two verses together. And that's why my friend said about forgiveness. I say, when your brother, sister loves you, rebuke him or her. That's not easy. And the Bible tried to say, do it in love. As in love, whatever language you use, rebuke is a rebuke. It hurts. But that's the job of doctors. And that's the job of preachers. You hurt, but you heal. Your aim is not to hurt. Then it says, if she or he comes 7 times and comes back, thank God, if he or she can, 7 times, that's not easy. Forgive. So the question is asking, faith to ask forgiveness and faith to give forgiveness. That's how I look at it. You Canadians, it's easy maybe to forgive or maybe ask forgiveness. Preachers at the times, they are Pharisees. They lay burden upon people, they can't put a finger on it. You call me from Congo, you go to Rwanda and ask Rwandans to forgive. Do I have any other message? I don't. Do I have a choice? No. Should I say love? There is no love in Rwanda. Empty. They hate each other. So what message do I have? Forgive. Who am I asking? A widow.